Well, sorry that the tyranny of the clock is the suffering of all its own. And we'll try to pick up where you left off. I mean, I think you were really hitting a stride there. Well, we do have time to take questions, 45 minutes for questions, so I invite y'all to approach microphone, and if you have any thoughts or questions, ideas, notions, comments. Well, let me just kick off the questions then. So, Rinpoche, you were talking about like the meta mind dealing with suffering, the mind almost amplifying suffering by focusing on the suffering, and that a person might be able to transcend the suffering if they're able to distance themselves from that by applying meaning to the suffering. And I recall a story of about American GIs in World War II taking heavy casualties and wounded, and many of the GIs passing up on the morphine, so that because they felt that a fellow GI may need it more, that they had brothers in arms who were in worse shapes than them, and they were individually facing what one might consider extreme suffering, and they turned it into mere pain, I guess you might be able to say. So am I kind of going down the right road and discussing what you're thinking, what you brought up?
You mean looking at the pain situation?
Yeah, I would wonder about the definition of suffering in regards to pain.
Is
suffering extreme pain, or is suffering pain in the absence of hope?
Suffering basically is the, dukkha that I was speaking of earlier.
Yes.
So it's not necessarily just extreme physical or mental pain, but it's the basic sense of dissatisfaction or uneasiness or, disturbed state, whether it's physical or mental. But yes, that sense of extreme pain, if we can make friends with that pain, let's say strong physical pain,
of course, it sounds almost cavalier to say that. Well, here we are in perfect comfort sitting here, but to do that while you're in the midst of dealing with some extreme circumstances, cancer, end of life, other conditions, it's very difficult.
Yes, it's not easy, that's for sure. But I think, of course, with the help of, I'm not saying we shouldn't take any kind of medical care. We must have a professional care. Along with that, if we can work with our mind a little bit for pain, and working with making friends with the pain as much as we can, that actually makes a big difference. Whether you want to bring pain into your sight and make it a friend, or you want to treat it as an enemy until you die, right? It's going to be there anyway.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, so we have questions. Go ahead. let's see how we're doing with the audio.
Sure, that's
now it's on. Now it's on.
Yeah.
When I'm a very young student, can you all hear me with my back to you?
It's harder, but we can.
Because you were nice and you asked me nicely,
Well, now I've taken over the audience. I'm sorry, I have to do it this way now. Because you asked me nicely, I'm going to let you have some blood. And he relaxed his arm, and the syringe filled with blood. And I was 19 years old and looked at him and thought, how did he do that? What is the mind that happened? So I got the blood. I have spent my entire career as a psychotherapist and as a nurse and as a theologian trying to figure out how he did that. And we're coming to understand the body-mind. So I have a question and an observation based on that. Beat that story, why don't you? How do the three of you approach the body-mind in this suffering when we touch one another, the purpose of suffering, the meaning of suffering? How do you, from the perspective that each of you hold, what is our mind in such a way that it transforms or shapes the body and transforms the illness, the pain, the suffering? Go for it.
Well, doctors are pretty concrete about pain. Doctors are concrete about pain because it's such an important element in our diagnosis of illness. There are lots of kinds of pain, and many of the kinds of pain point to a certain type of illness in the body. So physicians ask a lot of questions about pain. How does it start? What brings it on? What makes it worse? What relieves it? Is it positional? I mean, we have a lot of questions about pain, physical pain. That does not get to your question of how the pain is actually perceived by the patient and what it also may mean to the patient. In my exposition, I try to differentiate between pain and suffering. Because pain, if it is caused by some organic illness that I'm trying to diagnose and treat, if I make the right diagnosis, usually there's a way for me to treat the pain. But suffering is much more in the mind than it is in the body. And physicians are often not as alert to suffering as to pain, because suffering requires knowing a lot more about the patient than we tend to want to find out today in our very technologically oriented system of medical care. Suffering is much more difficult to treat, but once we know our patients and ask questions that are not necessarily medical questions, but philosophical questions, questions of self and selfhood, sometimes we can get to the basis of suffering. And when we do, when we deal with suffering directly, and we give of ourselves and our time, I've often noted that if I deal with suffering, I can also deal with pain much easier, much more easily.
You know, when you go to the hospital, there's a chart on the wall sometimes. Pain's looked at very linear. There's a little happy faces, a little happy, and they get sadder and sadder and sadder further right you go, and the one on the further right is like, just, oh my, this guy's in bad shape. But there's no cross, it's linear, there's no other
dimension
of the state of actuality of self or anything like that, you know. So how does a doctor approach that?
Well, I guess you're directing the question to me, but I would say, you know, in an acute situation, someone's in the hospital, very often they're admitted because they're in pain. Mm-hmm. It's our job to diagnose the cause of that pain and do our best to deal with it. That's the acute situation. But say you find that the patient's pain, abdominal pain, is not something simple. It's not appendicitis. You call a surgeon and the patient's better in 24 hours and goes home. Say you find, like in one of the cases I presented, or two of the cases, that the patient has a serious medical problem. And you evaluate that medical problem, and then you might have bad news for that patient. You may have actually done something to relieve the patient's pain temporarily, but the patient is left with a serious medical problem that's going to change the life of that patient forevermore. Happy faces don't deal with that, right? You deal with that over time by getting to know your patient, being able to speak honestly and forthrightly with the patient. It's only then that you begin to plumb these other dimensions of that patient and how he or she is dealing with the illness, with the news, with the diagnosis, with the difficult therapy that may lie ahead. But that is the hard part of our job. The easy part is figuring out what's wrong. The hard part is dealing with the patient, the patient's family, after the pain has been diagnosed, ameliorated. Mm-hmm. You're often left with a situation in which, in order to relieve suffering, you must plumb your patient's dementiality. And it's hard to do. It takes an emotional investment. Some doctors are naturals, others are not. It can be taught. It can be modeled. But it has to be something that is reinforced throughout a career. And you know, they don't call it, they don't say it's the practice of medicine for nothing. It takes practice. It's a continual practice. But I believe that many, many of my colleagues, most of my colleagues, with time, do understand to make this distinction between pain and suffering.
Well, Dr. Winokur is absolutely correct. The only note that I would add is that pain is absolutely essential. We couldn't live without pain. In other words, the worst thing that could happen to us is if we were totally and 100% free of pain. Because as Dr. Winokur pointed out, unless you are in pain, physical pain on some level, there's no way of knowing what's the matter with you. And so that signals something that's happening to you that should be remedied. The problem of pain, it seems to me, is A, where it's chronic, and it's sort of continuous and continuous and continuous and continuous, and we don't have an easy way of dealing with it. And secondly, where it's basically unbearable, because the alternative of saying, okay, we can handle the pain, but we handle the pain at the cost of your losing really consciousness or being totally drugged. And so the real problem is, how does that pain fit into a person's sense of the loss of self? In other words, when one really feels that their self is being threatened, their sense of who they are, the capacity to relate to others, the capacity to fulfill the roles that they were used to, and these are no longer possible, then you go from simple pain to perhaps what we would call suffering. But I would say, in my experience, the worst kind of pain is not physical pain. That's what I tried to say in my remarks, is where a person is overwhelmed with guilt or grief or feeling that they've missed their opportunity to do what they had to do in their life, that now it's too late. You see, it's this is profound suffering. And how do you deal with that? It's not just a matter of saying, you know, well, I have to look at it on the bright side and have these happy faces. I have to confront myself. I have to confront the worst within me. And then I have to say, how do I remedy that? Now, here's where I think religion can play a role. And I think that this is an important thing for us to look into. But apropos of your question, the thing that's interesting with respect to mind-body, we just don't know the answer to that question. For example, how do we explain hypnosis? How do we explain, I've seen situations where a person is hypnotized and they don't bleed. They're cut, but they don't bleed. Well, how do you explain that? Well, how do you explain with the fact that a person under hypnosis can do things that normally they're incapable? I would say you would bet your life you couldn't do that. Then under hypnosis, you find yourself able to do that, to lift things that you never dreamt you could and so forth. So we just don't really know the powers of the mind, and we don't really understand the relationship between mind and body. Now, I think the mistake is to have a kind of a reductionism, and this is the sadness. If you are basically within the context of a medical context where you're constantly looking for a physical cause for everything or a physical basis for everything, and you don't allow an alternative kind of a mind or a soul or something like that, that becomes a problem. One of the great, in my opinion, tragedies of psychiatry is that psychiatry today is basically organically oriented. Well, okay, let's see what's the best medicine for this particular. We're not actually saying, what is this illness, this depression, this anxiety? How does that fit into a person's self-understanding with respect to what that life means to them? That's the issue.
Okay, more questions. Annette.
Hi, my name's Annette, and I'm from San Antonio. I guess my question, I'm going to start with the question and then explain the question, is as panelists, as what you present for me is very empowering, very clear, and very missing in my experience of the healthcare system here in our Western society. I just recently, a couple of months ago, had broken my arm and had went through the whole process. And I noticed there were a lot of questions that were lacking in my care. And I had to, you know, I was grateful for my own personal travels with spirituality and religion. I was raised Christian, but later in life I chose Buddhism as a study. And the practice of Tonglen meditation has been the greatest way for myself to transform my suffering, because it's about taking in the suffering and getting it that my heart has the capacity to hold that. And so I find myself, like any other human being, getting caught up in my own personal pain, whether it be mental, emotional, or physical. I'm like everybody else. I take it personal. I want it to go away. But when I take that in and get it that I'm not the only one in this very moment who's suffering, it diminishes my pain. It never fails. I also walk in circles of other groups of people where our whole philosophy is that the way we help ourselves is by helping others. And I get to see that anytime I get out of myself, I'm helping somebody else, it diminishes my pain. Now, when I experienced my experience with having the break, having the surgery, and then going into physical therapy, I found that it was all very linear. There were nobody ever asked, what body did I bring into this injury? They only talked about the specific injury itself and what course of action we were going to go through to rehabilitate that injury. But I have a body that I brought into that injury, so I had, you know, whatever complications come with that body as well. And I just found it very frustrating found myself actually pulling out from that physical therapy to create my own physical therapy, which my insurance won't pay for. But there's a missing there. This is, you know, I felt very enriched by what you all had to share. And I'd like to know, you know, like, how many students, how many physicians are in this audience listening to this? And how is this being presented to the students who are learning to become doctors? And how is this being presented in the hospital so that this change is being made, that, that people are being asked, you know, what is your understanding of what's going on here? What does this mean to you? Because I just found it very disheartening when I went through that experience. And I know that I was grateful for what I had that I could use for myself to support myself through that process. So that's my question. What is being done to present this to students and physicians who are out there touching people on all levels? So thank you.
Well, I'd like to say that your experience is unusual, but it is not. And I think that our fragmented medical system now, unfortunately, is disappointing in a lot of ways to a lot of patients. And that is something that I think that we have to work on as a medical institution, as medical educators, as individual physicians, as medical professionals, not just physicians, but nurses and therapists of every ilk, is that we do tend to concentrate on the parts and not the whole person. I do want to say one quick thing that has bearing on your question, but also the other question. You know, mindfulness is making its way into the medical literature. Mm-hmm. There are people that write about mindfulness and meditation as a way to help pain, to deal with post-traumatic stress disorder, cancer, particularly in the nature of pain and suffering. So I think that physicians are becoming aware that mindfulness, meditation, are things that can help. It's certainly not in the mainstream, but there is certainly getting to be a literature in that regard. And I think that it behooves all of us who are medical professionals to learn about this, because we can help patients by thinking about some of these issues.
Did you want to add something, Mr. Rinpoche?
Did you want to say anything? Did you want to add something?
Yes, not much. But I've attended a meeting at the Johns Hopkins Medical University in DC area on pain management through mindfulness and meditation practice, mainly targeted for children who are suffering from terminal disease. And so I think, like you just mentioned, I think this kind of thing is taking place in some part of the, I think, medical healthcare communities. But that's all I have to add. I don't know the details of what's going on.
So let's go over here, sir.
If I may, the title of our meeting is Religious and Secular Approaches to Suffering and Healing. I rise to point out that we haven't talked about secular. The issue for me is that our knowledge that we bring from medicine, I am a physician, to the arena is basically secular. It is independent of religion, if you will, as many other things are, footnote Galileo, if you will. But the great spiritualities and religions of the world do not address, the terrible complexity of CAT scans, MRIs, the human genome, and pathology slides. And I would submit that the nexus of this thing is to translate the secular knowledge that we have to an individual patient. Mrs. Jones, you have a severe case of intimal hyperplasia. I'm going to bet that there's not a lot of Mrs. Joneses that understand that. If we can translate that to your blood vessel walls seem to be thickened, and may cause a problem for you if we do not address that issue, such as a stroke. Now Mrs. Jones might understand. But part of our issue is to take this tremendous amount of secular knowledge and focus it on one patient and one set of healing circumstances as we go through the process.
That's correct. That's absolutely right.
Excellent point.
Yes, sir.
Hi, my name is Javier Barranco. I'm a senior pre-med student at UTSA. And I have two questions for Mr. Ryan Poche. Sorry if I pronounce it.
Yes, okay. Yes, that's okay.
Which is not my first language.
That's okay. Good, yeah.
Okay, so you stated in your presentation that change causes pain, right? So
Suffering. Yes.
Yeah, change causes suffering. So does that mean that if a person is undergoing a disease, an illness or something like that, the process of healing as well, does that cause suffering? And my other question is that viewing your approach from a biologist point of view, all the universe is in constant change. So does that mean that we are in a constant suffering, and does the state of not being in suffering does not exist? Like, are we always suffering?
Thank you.
You take this one.
Oh, I think maybe you can answer that for me. Yes. Well, first of all, the basic teaching that I was presenting from the Buddhist point of view is that whatever is in the nature of a change, which means a constant, in the process of constant deterioration, right? Like our body, it doesn't get younger, right? It gets older each second, right? It's changing. So that kind of change, right? It's kind of deteriorating, it's changing. You know, even when we go through a medical treatment to get better, we're still not getting younger, right? Even we have a new lips and so forth, but we're still the same age or getting older. And so that kind of constant change, this kind of what we call impermanence, right, is basically bringing us some element of suffering. Like I think our pen's friend here, Dr. Winokur, is it? Made a wonderful distinction between pain and suffering, right? So it's like the suffering part that we're talking about, the mental pain or mental suffering. And secondly, yes, definitely, there's a state where we can be free from suffering, definitely. We can achieve that through, let's say, when we can really see how we can work with our mind, right? How we can work with our mind, and if our mind can rest in peace, calmness, and reach this level of resting or, making friends with any situation, right? Then you can be happy in any situation, right? It's that's possible, definitely.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
I could say a lot of questions, but I'm just going to stay with one. I'm going to talk about myself, and I shouldn't, but I'm going to talk about myself, about my problem. I have an 8-year-old stroke, and if I could get somebody to talk about. I've been trying to get over it, but I still got it 8 years old, and I want you to talk about that. That's all. I'll add a little bit more. I like what they say about God. I'm a 58-year-old. I'm 68. Well, I've been preaching since I was 10 years old. I'm a man of God. I'm not a preacher. I'm a man of God. So that's what I like to tell you. I respect those men over there because they're talking about God. And if you let God take over whatever it is, I think it will happen. I'll get better, but like they were talking about pain, he's talking about you think the pain will go away, it will go away. I've never had any pain. Eight years with this stroke, and I never had any pain. But I do have the stroke. I can do almost anything I used to do, except the names. I don't remember them, and a lot of things I don't remember. That's something that goes on. I guess I don't know what it is. So it's up to you.
All right, thanks. Appreciate your contribution. Human comments? Okay, thank you very much, sir. Anything? Okay.
Well, it's a story of perseverance.
Yes.
And it's good for us all to hear a story such as that.
Yes, ma'am?
I'd like to ask, from our religious leaders, in the case of terminal illness, with terminal patients, what are the religions that you know the answers for? How long do you do your religions allow patients to suffer before you say enough is enough? I know you can't pull the plug, we can't legally pull the plug, but at what point do you stop going to all costs to continue the patient's life and let up on medications that are life-saving and just go to palliative care? What is your religion's opinion on that?
She asked for the religious.
Religious, yeah.
I was asking the doctor to answer that question. Well, let me put it in a more general sense. I think that all too often in my experience, and we were discussing this before the presentations, we find people dying in intensive care units. And I don't think that's an appropriate place to die. And I had my own experience of a situation where a younger person was in an automobile accident. It wasn't someone I knew. I was visiting someone in the hospital. But they wouldn't allow this individual to go into intensive care from the emergency unit because the intensive care was full. It turns out that this young man died, and 2 days later, one of the people in the intensive care unit also died. And there was really no real reason why that person couldn't have been transferred and put into a normal room and what I would call intensive comfort care. I think it's very hard. There are always instances where individuals, and Dr. Winokur himself gave the example of his mother before, who really, for all intents and purposes, one would say, look, she really is in such bad shape that...
His father.
So I think that several things one has to keep in mind. The first thing is, is that person fighting for their life? In other words, is there a real intense desire to continue to live? Secondly, is the prognosis one that that would indicate there is a possibility of real cure, let's say, or at least some modicum of a normal life? Then you have all these advanced directors, and you have, what is it, an aphasia course? What is that, Chuck, what is that called?
Advanced directive.
No. There's an actual.
What?
No, there's a way in which you actually fill out, where you look at the background, you look at the whole variety of factors that would contribute to whether that person even should enter into intensive care or not. There's a whole range of protocols that would in a sense, lead one to make that kind of conclusion. So I would say that in general, my inclination would be not to keep the intensive care unit as a place where people die.
But is this the Jewish? I'm asking what the Jewish law is. Is there a Jewish law on this?
Well, I mean, you know, Jewish law and Jewish practice are two separate things. The Jew.
I know that.
According to Jewish law, one person, you should really strive, according to the Jewish halakha, you should strive to keep a person alive unless death is really imminent. And by imminent, I mean in the next day or so, or the next hour or so. But in practice, that simply isn't the case. In practice, people would say that if there's really no chance whatsoever of any kind of recovery, then what you, like my own teacher, Hans Jonas, has himself written extensively on this, saying you should just literally stop all life supports and let the patient die. But to continue artificial procedures, I would say even from a Jewish point of view, there's no reason in the world to keep a person from a halakhic point of view artificially alive.
Yes.
It's only if you take everything away and then see what happens. So there's a distinction between keeping alive artificially and just allowing nature to take its course. And here I would be on the side of those who say, let nature take its course when there's no real reason to continue the treatment.
Well, I have to say, do you want to say something?
Go ahead. Well, from the Buddhist point of view, I think generally I think many of the points, I think what Rabbi just mentioned, I think we agreed there. And I think Buddhist principle is it's really up to the individual. Okay, if the individual who is sick and in such care, you know, they should be the primary decider, and they should decide. You know, in the case where they can make this decision, then whoever's responsible should make the decision there. But the key point here is we believe in more like a natural process, you know, not like artificial life. And so I think what just Rabbi mentioned about, you know, if there's a real intention, that person want to be on such support, number one. And number two is if there's a really hope that it can bring some, you know, positive results to bring back some sort of life and so forth. And so I think, generally, individual decision, that's why I think it's important not to forget to write your will.
Thank you.
I just want to say, it's one thing to talk about Jewish law and Buddhist principles, but in America, it's a very, this issue that you bring up is an incredibly complex ethical issue with lots of legal ramifications. You know, our guiding principle is autonomy. What the patient or a legally designated surrogate decision maker have decided to do in a patient at end of life or with great suffering. And we need that information. That's why it's so important that we have, that medical professionals push for pretty explicit advance directives. Now, there are three states in America where you can, if you're a competent individual and you are have a terminal illness, go to your physician and talk about physician-assisted suicide when the time comes. That's only three states. I think this is a movement that's growing. But it's complicated. There are ethical and legal as well as moral issues here. And I think it probably goes beyond the scope of this discussion to get into that more tonight.
This is the last question, I'm sorry. Yes, ma'am?
Hi. Rinpoche, my question is actually inspired by what you were saying about using the mind as a way to transcend pain and suffering.
Can you say that again?
Pardon?
Can you say that again? I can't.
Yes. I said my question is inspired by what you were saying about using the mind as a way to transcend pain and suffering. I had an
brief experience of working on palliative care unit and working. The idea there was to bring comfort to the people, just bring them their food and things like that, but also the idea that they were saying on that ward was that you can still die healed. But there was one person that stood out to me a lot, and she had Alzheimer's, and she was on her deathbed, and she was alone, and she was fearful. And my grandmother went through the same thing. So I'm wondering, when you don't have the ability to use your mind as a tool, mm-hmm. And if anyone else can comment on that as well, what can someone do when they're just watching somebody in a lot of mental pain and probably physical and...
Like Alzheimer's.
Alzheimer's, dementia, mm-hmm. advanced schizophrenia, things like that.
Yes. Actually, I was staying with a friend in London many years ago, and one of the friends just passed away from, bad Alzheimer's disease. And so he was telling me that only thing she could remember towards the end of the stage was songs. They can remember songs because songs are memory that's stored in a different part of brain or something like that. I'm not really expert on that, but and so I think that was really nice. He said they sang songs all the time. That was really wonderful. She could remember the whole song. And so I think it would be nice to sing, in that situation, for example, singing some nice, cheerful songs, or if that person is a religious, then nice to sing whatever religious hymns or, praises that you sing and so forth. Or if you're a Buddhist, singing some kind of, those weird Buddhist songs and stuff like that. And I think that's one thing. And the other thing is I always tell my friends that, what I feel is most beneficial and important is not really bringing any kind of complex religious concepts or ideas to this person that we are trying to help, but to create really a genuine space of love and peace, a condition, a home, so to speak, of love, kindness, and peace. And so if we can bring them that support, from our physical and mental efforts, then I think that's the best support that we can give. Genuine love, a space of love, kindness, a house of love and kindness, a house of genuine peace, tranquility.
Now, I have to second that. My father had a long struggle with Alzheimer's disease, and that's really the subject of my book. My family dealt with him over a period of 7 or 8 years as he declined. And we tried to honor whatever remained of his personality, of his memories. And we did things like play music, sing. My brother would say, he would always, he thought he had a good visit with my father if he could make him laugh in some way or other. And so I think that taking care of a patient with an advancing dementia and being a loving, caring patient caregiver is a difficult task, but it can be done. You'll need professional help along the way, but what the Rinpoche brought to the discussion is quite true and lasting.
Can I just say one thing?
Yes, sir.
I just want to say that it's very important when a doctor treats a patient or has any contact to see that the other has an inner self, that it's always a subject to subject relationship and not a subject to object relationship. And I think that's the point that you were making. In other words, when Leviticus says, love your neighbor, for he is like you. And how is he like you? Because there is an inwardness to that other person, and you have a sense of your inwardness, and you have to connect not just to the object, but also to the subject, that it's a soul-to-soul relationship. And you see that even if a person has Alzheimer's or severely debilitated or, you know, and really limited. And I think once we keep remembering that all the time, so that it's not just an object that I do tests on and that I treat, but a subject who has feelings and has a soul, I think that's really the important thing.
And I think that also goes, I mean, we're not all doctors or medical caregivers here, but we all are going to be touched by this subject in very deep personal ways. I know so many things that were mentioned tonight brought back a lot of memories about me and the loss of my mother and my father. I know that we'll all be able to take something away from this discussion. We're all healers in one way or another. And take what you said about not looking at the object, but going further, even at my own mother and my own father when they're on their deathbeds, it was seeing them differently, and the relationship was differently, and seeing them stripped down as an individual, and relating to them in a different way as they made their exit. But we do have more in store for you this evening. Thank you so much for our panelists for being with us this evening. I want to give them a round of applause.
Ladies and gentlemen, before you break, I want to point out, just make a couple of points. You know, throughout history, all of humanity and every culture share in common, I think, at least two experiences. And one is that tradition of breaking bread together in order to form community, and also the need that we all have to find meaning in our suffering by sharing it with others. And I hope that this conversation that we are about to embark on is something that you will join us for. Four things. One, sit with people you do not know, please. Two, please participate actively in the discussion and maintain an attitude of respectful curiosity so that you might come to appreciate the perspective of a person who has a different perspective from your own. And finally, remember that the table hosts, each table will have one or two facilitators, are really there to facilitate conversations and not to answer questions. Please join me in thanking our distinguished guests.
I'm sorry you didn't say it. It was important for you to say it.
Right.